I just had the privilege to meet Jane. I actually was a member of the Enterprise IT organization. So I worked for the equivalent of Nelson Vincent. And I was in a role of business relationship manager. So I was representing the various services of the Enterprise IT organization to a large portfolio of on-campus customers, one of which was the research community. Two gentlemen came to one of our senior directors and said, we need help identifying an electronic lab notebook. We keep screwing it up here at Ohio State, and we need to do it right and get it right. We've lost a lot of money trying to figure this category out. So I got tapped with the dubious honor of helping them. So we assembled a stakeholder committee of 12 individuals in research, research-related IT. What other roles did they have? Staff, researchers, all related to research. We met, took way too long, a year and a half. Had the Internet 2 relationship been in place, that we would not have vetted the category like we did. But we actually went through about 12 different vendors, reviewing their capabilities. And after a lengthy process, and I was really at that time just serving as project manager, we landed on Lab Archives. They really, really liked the platform. One thing led to another. A very comprehensive presentation was made to the head of research, and she was thrilled. And I ended up then eventually going to work to Lab Archives, and which has been a wonderful experience because I'm now getting out and meeting with just wonderful university folks in the 8-state region about Lab Archives and about what's going on in the area of research. So enough about me. I'm not going to make this a sale pitch, nor am I going to make this a training session, or really a demo, but just to educate you so you can ask questions about Lab Archives and ELN. I'll take you in and do a quick surf, but Tiffany has set up this month, we're calling it Training Tuesdays. So every Tuesday, she's got a training session scheduled. We had a live lunch and learn this week that I hear was very, very well attended. My colleague was here. And then we've got two more webinars, right, coming up on Tuesday. So she can educate you about that a bit more. So does everyone understand what an electronic lab notebook is? If not, I'll take you through this real quickly. It's a secure, at least from Lab Archives' point of view, okay? A secure lab, a cloud-based collaborative platform for researchers, instructors, and students to organize, document, protect, store, share, collaborate, and publish their research data. We like to refer to it as a living repository, almost interactive in nature, because of the collaboration capabilities, the search engine, the data storage, publishing, and workflow software. I'd like to stop here and add one caveat so I don't mislead you when we refer to data storage. We're not a data warehouse, like a SQL or a Python or R. I mean, we can take large data sets, but we're not a data warehouse where you can go in and, like, Qualtrics is another, go in and do data analysis. We're a workflow. You want to attack, we can upload a lot of data that you already have in place. We take most files. We can upload at one fell swoop 250 megabytes. Now, we do have a megafile uploading capability that has not been acquired by the university, but perhaps it will be at another point in time. But we can, like if you've got a data set that's already established, now we can take it if you want to build it. We've got widgets that you can build your data sets, but we've got, you can pull it in if it's under 250 megabytes. Okay? Other than that, I'll show you in a minute, you can just link to it and keep it where you have it. If you've got it in Box, or you've got it on a supercomputer somewhere here on campus. Our most common research usage, I documented for you so you can see it varies. It's very interesting. We're getting more and more soft researchers, I call, like sociology. And the woman here who spoke this morning from, what was it, her research in music? Musicology. Yeah, so we're getting more and more diverse usage. We are a discipline agnostic workflow solution. So why keep records? This is from just lifted recently from the Department of Health and Human Services. Why keep daily records? Why keep a daily workflow submotion? Establishes good work practices and ethics. Teach people in your lab, if your PI is here today. Maybe you are a lab member of another PI group. Meeting contractual requirements for grants, avoiding fraud, defending patents, allowing work to be reproduced by others to facilitate the preparation of reports, presentations, and papers, particularly for those grant recipients, obviously, to validate your research and to serve as a source of assigning credit to lab members. And again, this is very recently published by the Department of Health and Human Services. A bit about lab archives. So you know how our footprint in universities today, we've got over 155,000, and that number is going to be updated here April 1st, every quarter, using lab archives around the world, and that includes two Nobel laureates. This is just a quick snapshot of many of our users. As you can see, got logos here from not only in the United States, but we've got a huge, large user base in Australia. Our headquarters is San Diego, and then we also have various offices, and that's me up in good old Columbus, Ohio. I would put Cincinnati up here, but I haven't asked for permission yet to use their logo. So that's the only reason they're not here. Interesting to note, 23 of the top 25 research universities today, this is rankings from National Science Foundation, are now using lab archives in a major way. I'd like to let you know that 30% of these universities right now also have enterprise licenses.
So what do you mean by a major way?
We've got a large amount of installations. Okay. Also, I mentioned Internet 2. Are you all familiar with Internet 2? Some? Internet 2 is a global community of leaders in research, academia, private industry, and government. There are 300 higher ed members. University of Cincinnati has a membership. This organization collaborates on innovative technologies in research and for public service. They have a vendor program called Net Plus Program. We were invited to become a Net Plus vendor by Cornell a few years back, and we were vetted and approved, and so we are one of, they've got a small list of recommended service providers to members in Internet 2, and we are one such recommended Internet 2 Plus provider, and we're very, very pleased about that. So let's step back in time now. Let's go back to the era of what can happen with paper notebooks. There are some researchers you know out there using paper notebooks. What happens? Mismanagement, potentially, or loss of documentation, or things get mixed up. I used to be, many, many years ago, the notebook queen. I wasn't even in research, but I was always keeping notebooks for everything, and then it would fall out and things would be everywhere. What's ironic, even though those who are keeping notebooks like this, many of them are still doing all of their research online and are working within other digital environments. So we're working not only to get folks like these and others who may be using another type of digital tool that isn't quite maybe as safe as it needs to be into using a solution like lab archives. So your components of your paper lab notebook, as you can see, very similarly, what I'm trying to show you is a contrast. It's all still there, but now in a notebook, digital notebook application form. So here's how data gets into an electronic lab notebook, a la like a lab archive. We'll take data from equipment, lab equipment, email attachments, direct entry, mobile devices, digital cameras, forms, and templates. We also have downloads and integrations. As I mentioned, one with Box. Microsoft Office, we're also integrating with Office 365. Do you have that here on campus? Okay, we're going to have that. We have an integration now, but we're upgrading to Office 365. I think it's 3Q. of this calendar year. We also work with GraphPad. Lots of folks in the medical side and pharma work with GraphPad. And then a few others, Bernier, Flojo, then the Google Docs and, what is that, Google Sheets. So it all comes together within your lab notebook and helps you then for your workflow and documentation for your research endeavors.
So if you're doing field research, can you easily get the data into this system?
Yes, okay. With your mobile app. We've got 2 mobile apps.
That's the only way?
Well, if you've got an iPad with you.
Okay. Or you can do it from a laptop?
Yes. We're browser-based.
So you have to have a live internet connection?
Yes. Or a mobile app. Well, you know, internet connection, yes. Yes, since it is browser-based. Oops. So, whoops, wait a minute. Sorry, okay. So, when we like to talk about benefits, I kind of washed out the classroom and students and instructors because I knew we're mostly research today. But let's talk about the benefits for you as researchers using lab archives, but the benefits to the university. And that's ensuring compliance of your data is secured, which we'll talk about it in a minute. You're proving to discovery, protecting the intellectual properties. The gentleman from technology commercialization is very important to him. We utilize existing authentication. We're already set up here now behind SHIP, which is your authentication to get into the University of Cincinnati network. We've also got a reporting dashboard for the site license administrator that Tiffany has access to. She cannot see research, but she can see the data amount of activity, and then she has various controls for the university to exercise, whether the university chooses to exercise them or not. There's also real-time backup, which I'm going to discuss more at length in a minute. We talked about we're discipline agnostic, and we support your data management plans for your grant submissions, which I'll emphasize that at the close. Also, benefits for you, obviously, standardizing your workflows, it's easy to use, paperless, time savings, automates and controls your data capture, facilitates collaboration worldwide or in your lab, helps you manage your data research remotely. If you want to get in at home at night, you can get right in your home laptop. You don't need to take anything with you, or on your iPhone for that matter, or your iPad. We could provide a complete audit trail, and then there's unlimited storage now that there's an enterprise license, which is a wonderful, wonderful benefit.
So if you're doing like a GLP study for industry, say the EPA is funding a study, and you have to make every single possible note has to be written down, and you have to do corrective actions and audits and things like that. Would this support that?
Oh, absolutely.
Okay, because that's a big paper job. I've done it before.
Do it right in the notebook.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So the lab archives advantage. Key points I want to point out to you in using an ELN. The ease of use and time savings. Once you start down the track, you'll never want to go back and say, why didn't I do this sooner? We have 2 versions. We have the professional, which for your use, and then we have a classroom version, which we have a very large footprint now, just under 100,000 students who've used it. It is the same as what professional researchers would use, like yourself, but there's a course manager for the instructor and TAs toggled to it, which allows the TAs and instructor to push out content to view how the students are doing and to grade. It's very, very nice. We have the cloud partnership with Amazon Web Services, so there's bank level security. We also have a functionality embedded in our lab, in our solution, that's in accordance with the National Institute of Standards of Technology to protect your intellectual property rights. For those of you who it's important to, it's a date and time stamping that can never be changed. And it also, we then embed a signature stamping so you can freeze a page, or a researcher can, when the work is complete, so it can never be altered. I mentioned the Internet 2 connection. I also mentioned Fox. We just discussed not all ELNs work within multiple browsers, and that's a real nice advantage of that archive. And then the fact that we provide two different mobile apps at no cost, and they're actually being upgraded. So our 2.0 versions are being released this summer. I hear they're quite nice as well. We also provide complete audit trail, very important in scientific discovery. So you'll always be able to go back to a page. Say you've changed something on a page or graph, and you want to go back to a version 3 months ago, it will be there. You just drop down the audit trail, find it, and bring it back up. Very, very nice to use. And you don't have those luxuries in an Evernote or even like on a paper notebook. So this makes it lovely. We also have that universal notebook search functionality, which is a wonderful, wonderful capability for all of you in research. I'll show you briefly in the top, there's a search functionality. So you want to put in a tag or some type of word that to look for something. Because once you have a license to use LabArchives, you can have as many notebooks as you want. So this search functionality searches across all notebooks. Like, I can't remember where I put such and such or research related to, you know, whatever subject matter, if it's cancer related, of a certain organ or something. You put the information in, just like search in Google, and boom, it'll pull it all up for you to find it across all notebooks. We also have the search capability across chemical structures as well. We also, really nice for your use, is a widget library. Various widgets. Widgets are HTML forms, for those of you who don't know the term. And we also have a customizable widget maker, which is, I think, very unique for the ELN category. And then, as I mentioned, comprehensive federal guidelines compliance. This is really important to universities like yours today with high-level type secure data that needs to be secure. We've met compliance guidelines of Internet 2, but we also have met compliance guidelines of the FDA 21, CERC Part 11. That's for intellectual properties, by the way. We are also HIPAA compliant. We're FERPA compliant. Section 508 accessible, those are, we meet the accessibility requirements, 85% I would say, we're not 100 there. It's very hard to be 100%, but our VPAT is online and it's really for those with visual impairments. And then we are also FSMA compliant, and we are also going to start work April 1st on being ITAR compliant. That's becoming more and more important with universities and research today. This is for high level research. Highly secure research data. When it comes to information security, we do proprietary logon options with SHIV, as we discussed. Our cloud partner, as I brought up, is Amazon Web Services, providing you bank level securely 24/7, where the servers are monitored not only by Amazon Web Services, but by LabArchives. We have someone always not watching the servers, but making certain that everything is going well. Multiple data backups are happening throughout the day. You start using LabArchives, so you needn't be concerned. And we also have then your data is being backed up and stored in a location in Oregon. Your data is also secure because it's encrypted. And that's important for HIPAA. So your data is encrypted. If you're doing like clinical work within LabArchives or patient data, it's encrypted in transit and in rest and in backup form. That is a prerequisite for HIPAA compliance. No one has viewable access to your data. For those of you who have started using LabArchives, or I hope you will come on board, we cannot see it. Tiffany cannot see it as your lab administrator. No one from Amazon Web Services can see your data. Your data is your data and your lab teams. We have no viewable access. And as mentioned, your data is encrypted. Any questions about the security and compliance? Because obviously very important. Last but not least, I wanted to bring up, this is really something that's been brought to my attention since, I would say, June of last year. We support the federal granting agency's requirements for data management plans and it mitigates concerns about audits. the National Science Foundation is now requiring all of you who are requiring or are submitting for grants to submit a data management plan, and then how you're going to publish. I just recently worked with a researcher to finalize his plan for a $43 million grant at a major university, and that he's going to be collaborating with a couple other universities, and he, to get this money, he had to have a really nice data management plan. So I actually, he asked me to help him, so I said it. I spoke with Bill from NIH. The NIH is soon to require grant data management plans for all grants. He said, Carol, we're a little behind the NSF. He said, we've only been requiring them for grants of $500,000 or more, but it's, the landscape's changing. They're going to be requiring data management plans for all grants in the very near. He didn't give me a date. I didn't get it from him. I'll have to email, but it's coming. Okay. So with that, where do you go from here? I'm going to take you in just real quickly. I just am wanting to, just, I'm not wanting to sell, just educate and inform, because we're here now on campus and really hope you'll take advantage of the resource, those of you that have not. If you're here on campus, your contact, Tiffany Grant, right here, everyone knows Tiffany. We are doing Training Tuesdays through this month, and then after this month, we'll probably steer you, if we need to do more, we will. But we have weekly webinars, Lab Archives does. I think they're on Thursdays. If you're visiting from the outside, there's supposedly some folks here today from, NKU. And you're interested, please see me. Or there's my contact information, or I have a card here. I also have purple pins to give you all. Tiffany, in fact, I'll pass them out. I'll get asked you to pass them out. So you remember today. Let me take you into Lab Archives very quickly. We got 5 minutes, and I'll show you. I'll just take a quick tour. How's that? And then I'm out of your way. So here is Lab Archives, our book. This is one of my demo books. So I guess I'm just going to work on my laptop since I, let's see if I can, no, it's not up there. So think of your notebook. This is an electronic lab notebook. So on the left nav, here's all your files and pages. So I've got various files, lab information. I'm going to close it up. There you go. I've got three files here, lab, experimental, meeting notes. Here is where all my notebooks are stored. As you can see, I have multiple notebooks. Let's go back to one I have. I probably have about 50 at the moment. I need to get rid of some. I also have an inbox. This is a lovely feature. Say you're out on a campus somewhere at home. You're looking on your iPad like I do at night. See something of interest you want to send and then store or replicate. You just send it to inbox@labarchives.com, but you must send it from the email you're registered for your license in. So you'd have to switch to your email account from here at the university, and you can then send the information right in. It'll go in your inbox, and then you can put it in whichever notebook you want to put it in, and whatever page. It's very easy to use, and that's a lovely feature as well. So the basic structure is you've got the files, as I showed you, and the pages. I spoke to you about the universal search capability. Here it is. The drop-down, as you can see, search current notebook, all notebooks, selected notebooks. So this is all the information. You just load in and you search. Very simple and easy to use. Very, very easy and very intuitive. And then here's a, what I mentioned, the entry contains chemical structure. And this is based in SMILES format. Those of you who do chemical structures, I believe that's very, very common. That was just a nice new add as well. Those of you who are in medical, by the way, integrations that were under discussion, I forgot to mention earlier, we are in discussion with Red Cap. I don't know where that's going, but I know that's used a lot on university campuses. So integrations are important, and we recognize that. So, whoops, we don't need to look at the stock markets today, do we? So here's the rest of the nav bar. This is obviously identifies myself. This is a very nice feature. This is all our quick start guides. We've got a Facebook page. We have PowerPoint tutorials, video tutorials, blog, ask question. This is our knowledge base, very robust knowledge base. Our little hamburger, you've seen this often, has a drop down of a lot of different features. Dashboard, which you've got at the front, widgets. What's real interesting about Lab Archives, the developer put so many of the functionalities in different places. So if it's not one place, it's another. And you also have most of your features on a notebook level, a page level, or an entry level. So sharing, for example, you can share an entry, you can share a page, you can share a notebook. So it gives you many, many options.
So can you store, if you're like that, you're talking a lot about experimentation. If you're a modeler, you develop code, and you do modeling and you have results, can then all of that be incorporated in the lab notebook so everything's in one place?
Sure. Okay. We take almost any file upload. Yeah, yeah. Or they always tell me, Carol, say everything. We take all file uploads. There hasn't been one that.
But even a really, really large file.
200. Remember what I said? 250 megabytes.
Okay.
But you can link to it. Right?
Yeah, yeah. We have a linking capability. I'll show you.
Okay.
We do have a linking capability. See that link, that chain there? You can link. That allows you to link to a file elsewhere if you're doing an entry or an observation, and then you link to that.
Yeah, that's good.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I'm happy to.
All the intellectual property belongs to universities, so when they leave, the PI needs to be, take over all those labs.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. See this notebook settings over here?
Right.
Oops. So, notebook user management. So, you know, I should show you the group management. You have four roles within Lab Archives. Oops, notebook owner, the PI. I'm going to put Norm. Then you have the PI usually tasks a lab administrator. The lab administrator has all the same capabilities as the PI, because oftentimes the PI isn't in the book every day. And then the lab team members are users. They go in and they use the notebook. They cannot share. All these top-notch capabilities I talked to you about are the PIs and the administrators. Your user level can only work in the book. They can put comments to each other, and then they're pinged back and forth, or pings the PI, but they can just work. There is an added nice feature. Say Tiffany wanted to share something in her research with me, but I'm not here at the university. She can send me a guest, set me up as a guest, put my email in, send me a guest privilege into the notebook or the page. Again, it's on the level. And I have 60-day privileges to make notations in it. After that, I'm guest only. I can only view until I'm removed. Okay? And it's right over here in the privileges section, as I showed you. We'll go back. You see the full access, so this is a group. Perhaps the PI wants to make the whole group administrators, he or she might. So it's up to the PI how they want to structure it. Now also it's up to a lab team. Maybe the PI wants everyone to have their own notebooks and they're all owners. Usually that doesn't happen. Usually they're all the PI and the administrator. It's owner, administrator, and then user. I gotta go. Any questions? Any other quickies? I will be here afterwards if you have any further questions. I'm happy to, like I said, didn't want to do a demo. This wasn't training. This was just a quick tour. And to help you understand, hopefully, the benefits. And thank you so much for allowing Lab Archives to enter the university and to be a part of your research.
So hello, I'm Amy Koshoffer. I'm the science informationist for UC Libraries. And I'm going to talk also about an electronic lab notebook. This one is called the Open Science Framework. And I'm wondering if I'm beating a dead horse here. I hope not. I think I can just keep saying it again and again. All the benefits that you can get from an electronic lab notebook. As Carol said, you know, using Lab Archives or the Open Science Framework, there are these really great features of having all of your data electronically accessible to you. I just want to put a question out. Is there something that's not on this list? Are there other options or other features that people might think about? I also wanted to ask, how many people here are in STEM? If you're actually in a STEM field, raise your hand. What if you would consider yourself social science? Humanities? Okay. So I'm gonna come to that point in a little bit. But anyways, the Open Science Framework is developed by the Center for Open Science. And the Center for Open Science is about to celebrate its fourth anniversary. It is a not-for-profit organization interested in this mission statement of increasing openness and integrity and reproducibility of research. And they do that through offering products and services. One of the products that they offer is the Open Science Framework. There's a couple of flavors of it, and I'll talk about a couple of those later on in the presentation. The other way they support the openness and transparency and reproducibility of research is through the services that the center offers. They have statistical consulting, so actually a research group here can set up a Google Hangout and work with someone from the center and make sure that the research that they're doing is statistically sound. So they have experts and they can work with them and make sure that they are, you know, going in the right way for that. They also promote transparency and openness promotion guidelines. So if you are a publisher, you can adopt these guidelines to promote the openness of the research. And that's another one. They actually also support pre-registered reports. They can do that through the Open Science Framework, where you basically make a timestamp of a project, and so that it's held in a certain time, and you can show that the research, you can go back to it as a reference. Okay? Another way that they do it is through the challenges that they offer through the center, and also they have badges, so if you can reach certain levels of openness if you're implementing the guidelines there. I'm going to go into the Open Science Framework, give a little bit of tour of it. I'm going to log in through my account. Before I actually log in, though, there is a really nice video you can watch also if you want to review some of the components of the Open Science Framework. They have a lot of support in terms of documentation and answering questions. All the functionality of the Open Science Framework is addressed here through these different guides. They're just documentation, and you can look at how do you create a project, something like this. Go back here to support. A couple of frequently asked questions about it. I've heard some questions about Lab Archives. The same kind of questions come up with the Open Science Framework. The data upload limit is 5 gigabytes. The data storage is unlimited. So they have these features as well. The Open Science Framework, like I said, it's developed by the Center for Open Science. It is grant funded through the center. They have a backup plan. If they were to lose funding, it would just go into a read-only mode. But I think that it's gaining mobility. They'll get more and more funding, and you'll see more and more projects going into the Open Science Framework. Actually, they have a lot, and actually, it's all on their webpage.
Oh, okay.
So, it's one of the frequently asked questions. If I can find it, Well, they do get funding from the Institute of Library and, sorry, the Museum and Library Science. What else?
Was it one of the first questions?
Yeah, it might have been, yeah, okay. How are you funded? Yeah, here it is. So it has a whole list. They can bring it up. So they put all of their funders here. Okay, so here it is. Alfred P. Sloan. Let me go ahead and sign in. One thing I wanted to point out that you can sign in using an ORCID. I wondered how many people here have an ORCID or have heard of ORCID. ORCID stands for Open Researcher and Contributor ID. It's like a social security number for researchers. So if you have an ORCID, you can sign in to the Open Science Framework using your ORCID. I never remember my ORCID, so I actually am going to use my own email. And then you can see here that I'm signed in. It has a dashboard, so all of your projects come together in a dashboard. You have a profile, you can enhance your profile, put all of your social media contacts into your profile. Let me go back to my dashboard. And we can take I'm gonna go to this project actually. This is one where you might say, oh, Open Science Framework, does it mean that I'm doing research in a fishbowl? No, actually you can share when you want to share and as you need to share. So in this case, someone is sharing part of a project with me. I do not have access to the whole project. I only have access to one folder that I created and I put my content in there. One thing that I'm doing is I actually haven't loaded anything into the Open Science Framework. You can see right here it says Box. I'm actually sharing a document through my Box account with the Open Science Framework, and that's how the people in the research group access what I'm sharing with them. If I wanted, I could upload it into the OSF storage, and it would be under this link here. It shows you all the activity going on as we created the folder, as I put something in, so you can track the activity of all of the lab members or research group members and see what people are doing. You could log into this anywhere. Again, it's browser-based, so you can access it on any device. You can access it in any place. So it has that feature to be very mobile for you. If I wanted to see all the projects associated with it, I can click on the files. If I want to know who's looking at what, outside of the lab group, it collects analytics. So again, it's about openness and sharing. That information is recorded within your notebook here. And if you have a private, the reason this looks grayed out is because this is a private folder. If I make it open, then you get more access to analytics. Really, the Open Science Framework wants you to share and be open about the research process. They are very interested in the idea that if you make the process open, people do better science. People learn from other mistakes. If you share that, then people in general will do better science, and it improves science overall. So that's one of the goals of this. I talked a little bit about registrations. If you make a timestamp of the project, it'll appear under registrations. You can share pieces of the project and copy it, a fork, just like in GitHub. And you can also look at everybody that's on the project. If I were the administrator, I would have the ability to add people here as well. So that's just a little bit of a tour of the Open Science Framework, but I wanted to also say that it is looking for collaborators, so places where they find anywhere they can incorporate into an already established workflow, they will do that. So you can see a lot of Mendeley, other Zotero's there, GitHub, any place, Box, where they have these, where there are people that will work with the Open Science Framework, they can build these collaborations and integrations. One that we're working on right now is the possibility of incorporating our institutional repository. And as I mentioned, I wanted to say that the Open Science Framework, you hear the term open in science, and you may think, oh, working in a fishbowl, that's not for me. I want to, you know, I need to keep my project under wraps because we might get scooped or something. It's not really about working in a fishbowl. It's about being open when you want to or need to be open. It's also the term science. Really, it's more about the research, right? The scholarship. So it can be, this can be a tool for any discipline. It doesn't need to be STEM or something. I can show you an example of basically a humanities project that's being worked on within the Open Science Framework. They are archiving oral histories about the Women's March to Washington, and this is a perfect example of using this tool outside of what you would think of a STEM project, right? We are in the process of setting up OSF for institutions, so we will be setting it up for UC. This is an example of University of Notre Dame's, and I present this as an example because University of Notre Dame is also a Project Hydra partner, so they have a repository based on code similar to our repository. Linda was talking about Project Hydra earlier, and so they have the code to integrate with their repository already developed, and they're showing here, you know, all the workflow pieces that are connected to their framework, and then they are showing, you know, that they can push and pull from their repository. So they have that integration into the repository. Okay. Like I said, we are hoping to roll out OSF for institutions for UC very soon. This will be the URL when it's available. I was hoping to be able to have it available today, but I haven't heard yet that it's available. It'll probably be available next week, actually. Okay. If you're interested in learning more about the Open Science Framework, I'm willing to talk with you, do a demonstration for your lab group. You can email me directly. You can visit the webpage for our research data services group, or you can email askdata@uc.edu, and it will come to the research group. And that's all. If I have any questions about the Open Science Framework.